Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Seed Story Cup number 5. I am Nemsh, and I'm here with AK Wonder and RDU, AK the Rub God. So, how are you guys doing? Maybe AK Wonder first. Are you enjoying the event? Do you play even today?
Yes, of course. I feel like in home here, it's like so comfy to be.
It's your first time, right?
It's my first time here. I'm so happy to be part of this event. I really like it. It's just everything so smooth. You can like go downstairs, sit, relax, cast.
It's like at home, right?
Yeah, it is.
And RDU, this is. Have you been like to? I think you've been to 4 of them, right?
No, I have been to 2.
To 2 only? Okay.
Yeah. My other Seed Story runs are not that good. Today started really well. I just like 2-0'd very fast on the B stream.
Okay.
I don't know how many people watched that, but Zoo went really well for me. As for people on the A stream, so I'll not even be playing tomorrow. I have 1 day break and I play day 3 in top 16. So I'm really hyped for that. Now I'm just like chilling, casting some games, again relaxing. As AK Wonder said, like unlike a DreamHack, here you have like space to like just relax and like chill between the games. So you can perform even better than like open LAN tournaments. Yeah.
The event is really great, guys. We have a lot of small games. There are screens everywhere, so we can watch the games. But obviously, we wouldn't be able to do it without our sponsors. So I want to thank all our sponsors, and I show you also what is there for you. So let's start at our Facebook page. We do have a Facebook page for Take TV, and you can win some stuff. There is a raffle, guys. So !raffle. You can enter it. Let's see what it is. Like also on the Facebook page, which is basically facebook.com/TakeTV. And here we do have the raffle part by Need for Seed. You can win Sennheiser Game 1 Black. You can get some headphones, some keyboards from Logitech. Also, you can actually get a chair and some t-shirts and hoodies. So this is a really cool raffle, definitely. I don't think you have to do much. Just enter the form and get your data in here. And then you will be taking part in the raffle. But talking about the sponsors, we have Need for Seed. One of the sponsors here, and obviously Need for Seed was from the very beginning, Seed Story Cup was about Need for Seed. The chairs are great. We have those chairs downstairs. Have you guys tried the chairs downstairs?
Yeah, of course. We are always in chairs. Everything, every floor is full of chairs like this, so it's like...
And chair is an important part of the gaming career.
Yeah, I have a G2 Need for Seed chair at home. It's awesome.
Okay, that was really genuine, RDU. Thank you so much. Now we have also Logitech, one of our sponsors here, and I'm personally using Logitech gear. I really like it. Great keyboards, great peripherals. I've been visiting Logitech in Switzerland at some point, and the guys are really good, like technicians and how they test everything. It's really cool. And our sponsor is Sennheiser, the audio stuff. And I'm not sure, like, do you guys really into audio as well? Like, Carson has great music, but it's mostly like Sennheiser is really good on the market.
I usually play with the Hearthstone muted. But obviously, a good headset helps you like listen to better music. But I don't like the Hearthstone game sounds; they trigger me.
Yeah, but like you can use Sennheiser for any other.
Yeah.
Actually, and Sennheiser really has good headsets. And the last thing, but not least, and something that you can involve in again is Matcherino. And for the Matcherino thing, you can actually get a $3 that you can donate. Like basically, you donate and you can increase the prize pool here. And we have vouchers for you. We have the codes that you can use instead of donating your own money. Obviously, if you want to donate your own money, you're welcome to. So I'll just show you. You can sign in here. I'm signing in right now.
Wait a second, Nimsh. So if every viewer donates $1, the prize pool gets double?
We have a limit there, but you can try. You can try. So if you are signed in, you can donate, and then insufficient funds. But we actually
have
code. Yes, there is a coupon code. And I will reveal the coupon code right now.
Okay.
The coupon code
is...
It's Seed Story.
Wow, I bet even Sherlock Holmes would struggle with that.
All right, it's Seed Story, but this is actually a German keyboard, so I'm not sure why it is.
Yeah.
All right, so Seed Story is the code. And we can add fans to this.
So you donate for free?
Yes, you donate this. Let's donate $1. And I encourage you to donate this $1 for Seed Story Cup because it will actually add to the prize pool of the tournament.
Yeah, just make it bigger. Why not?
Make it bigger. Specifically for you guys, right?
Yeah, of course. Guys, make it bigger. It's for free.
Exactly. So big thanks to Matcherino being one of the sponsors of the event as well. But the next match, guys, is going to be Ecop versus Tice.
Wow. Pretty good match.
Yeah, his teammate, Tice, one of the best players in the world. no one has a doubt on it. And Ico is like really good player, of course.
He's one of the most underrated players. Like, yes. People when they hear Ekop, is like, oh, Ekop is in everything. But actually, Ekop recently plays like way better than he played when he was in everything.
Yeah.
So now like he has less chances to prove himself, so he wants to prove himself. He's something that you shouldn't underestimate. Like, his lineup is like pretty good too.
He's known as a memer, but he's really good.
Yeah, it's like the thing is like Ekop got better, but also the field got better. Like, there's many more players now who are in general better than like the beginning, I think.
I disagree. I think most new players are bad.
Oh, wow. Shots fired. Are you, please?
Easy.
Well, one of the new players, they can wonder, by the way. So he kind of fired, it's just you.
And you.
Sorry, man.
It's fine.
No, you're good.
But yeah, seriously, there's the more players, the more skill, and Ekop, you know, he's still like, he won so many tournaments in the beginning as well, but he's trying to like be there again in the spotlight, and winning versus China was a good first step. And even at Seed Story, he didn't win the Seed Story, but there was a Take TV invitation at some point that he was able to win at Take TV House, so he has the knowledge how to win a tournament here, not in this location, but in Prefall at least. So that's something.
Yeah. Do you think like when he enters the Griffield City, he has like some magical powers? Some guy in the sky just like bowls him with like some energy or something like that? I think that's how it works.
I think that if you win a tournament in a certain location, it will be easier for you to win the tournament again because you're in the right mindset. You're like, I've won here already. I've won once, so I can do it again.
Ideally, you'd better like play the same everywhere.
You were the repeat champion of the DreamHack. Was it easier to win the second DreamHack than win your first one?
I mean, I don't know. It's just like, I try to like play as good as I can. I don't think the seat influences me. Of course, the food influences me. So if the city has like good food, then I might play better. If he has like awful food, then I might play worse.
That's a really good, actually. There is a nice story about food and city. Firebat, first you finish the tournament. He ate some eggs, like scrambled eggs in the morning, and he felt sick after eating them. He won the Trinity one. He won the Trinity tournament. The second time, he went for the eggs again. He again felt sick and again won the tournament.
Oh, that's ballsy. What? So you get sick twice, what do you mean? So, yeah, just try again.
It was all about food, I think. So, are you? How about food?
I remember Tides of Time won the tournament in China because he didn't eat for 3 days. Because he didn't like food. Just didn't eat anything, just drink water. He wanted to run
out. Oh, healthy.
I see a relation between the food and the winner of the tournaments, clearly.
Yeah. Confirmed back, you wonder.
There is some for sure. They're still waiting for advance for the players. I think they're trying the best game at the very moment. But we're going to start it very soon. Just for you guys, this is the second game that's happening in this group. We have some time limitations, so I believe Reynard versus
Terrence is off stream. Right?
Yeah, they're playing off stream at the moment. So if we have the scores, we'll try to update you guys. But they are playing off stream, and this will be the main game on stream. Ekop versus Tice.
And one player from NA goes home after this.
That's right, because they play elimination match, and the winner of that match will be able to play versus the loser of this one. So this is about getting out of the group. Whoever wins this, it's out of the group, and then he won't have to play tomorrow. Tomorrow he can just rest, and then he'll then be free.
Yeah, it's like a lot of pressure when you play day one. If you win, it's very good because you can just chill day two. But if you lose day one, I mean, you can still chill, but you're like feeling pretty bad that you don't have to play. You watch other people, and you're like, oh, I want to play.
And support Team Anubis, please, hashtag Team Anubis.
No, Team Harris!
No, Team Anubis.
Who would you vote for the NA team, come on?
Yeah.
That's real.
You.
Well, at least you guys are not getting any points for that match. Because we have Team Anubis versus Team Anubis, so no points for you guys there.
That's cheating.
Well, Harris is not getting any points for Reynard versus Terrence, isn't it? As well, so.
Cheat to Reynard confirmed.
Alright, you got Reynard. Wait.
Usually, Thais will make the trade for you. So trading here, you just like give him some advantage, some health, actually.
Because you think Tice trades too much, or because it's the correct line?
Yeah, this is the correct line.
It's correct to trade a 5-1 into a 3-3. You want to get rid of your minions with very little health, because you can get punished afterwards.
But also, I like to play Deadly Poison and not trading here, the 5-1. What do you think?
I think it's bad to not trade.
How can you get punished?
I mean, let's assume like Echo had Ravaging Ghoul, he'll probably still play the Blood to Ichor. So he might still have Ghoul in his hand, in Taiji's mind. So you'd always trade here.
Okay.
Yeah, you play around Ghoul for sure.
You also don't want to like race with the Warrior. So both players played correctly.
Yeah, but Ikop really needs a 4-drop or something that he can play here because it... there's a
good pretty good.
Drop. Yeah, definitely. And now his curve looks actually okay. With Azujig on 5, then Crusher on 6.
That's a good top deck, actually. Well, you can play anyway Shadow Strike here, but maybe...
You can go teacher Coin Conceal and then next thing go like Shadow Strike Eviscerate is like super good.
Uh-huh. Yeah, wow.
That's... Because you use the tokens that you make with the teacher spells to like help you kill the 3-6.
And you know, he doesn't have goal because he didn't play it before. Well, maybe he played...
He could still have goal.
Yeah.
But if he plays if he plays the goal, yeah, you're in not the best spot, but... At least he doesn't play a 5-drop. You know that he doesn't have a 2, maybe, because if he had a 2, he would combine it with Blood to Ichor. Mm-hmm. So knowing he doesn't have a 2, you know that he probably will not have goal plus 2. So if he plays a goal, it's better than him playing a 5-drop. We're already going like next level, like predicting the...
Yeah, that's pretty much.
Yeah, definitely goal would be really good, because then you damage your Drake as well, so Shadow Strike can hit it. It's damaged now. But no goal there, just a simple Azure Drake to draw the card. And this means that, as Ardy, you mentioned, Shadow Strike and Eviscerate is super good.
Yeah, it's insane. But the issue is that from this point, Thais needs to like draw Auctioneer at some point. Because if he doesn't, he's going to run out of fuel. If Ekop hits turn 8, Ragnaros is going to like destroy Thais. Also, like if Ekop... will be able to like deal some more damage. The Draconid is going to be a threat unless Thais has sap. If he has sap, of course, he can like reduce the value that Ekop gets from the Draconid.
Well, from this perspective, like I agree with you, obviously, but from this perspective, like maybe like looking the hands, if Thais gets a sap, this can deny their 6. So slowly he can actually just keep dealing damage. And if no ghoul at all, you should be in a good spot overall.
I think the Rogue is going to play like Tempo Gadgetzan next turn.
What? No.
Why not?
You never want a Tempo Gadgetzan.
Like, what are you going to play?
Oh, we will see what he draws, right? Because
yeah, of course, but ways. Just...
Like, you have to evaluate the chance of him surviving. If he thinks the chance of Gadgetzan surviving one turn and then him having like spells that he can chain up to draw cards is decent, he'll probably play it. But usually you don't want to do it. It's like a fancy play. But again, if you have no other play and you think your opponent doesn't have the damage, yeah, sure, why not?
So now Ikop has either Fireworks to deal with the 3-3, or he can go for Frothing Berserker and execute, which means that he will lose Frothing to just a weapon attack. There is still the Deep Poison and one of the 1-1s.
Yeah, Frothing is bad. You go Fireworks, Hero
Yeah,
power.
I like Works as well.
Hero you feel safe at 28 HP, so... You can go Fireworks.
And the next turn you have Works as an activator for execute, and you have 6-6 as well.
If you top the Ravaging Ghoul next turn, it's going to be like the best turn ever. You go like Ravaging Ghoul, Frothing, execute, or Frothing, Ravaging Ghoul, execute, depending on if you want to get a buff on Frothing for the one damage or not.
Yeah, from Ico's perspective, it's looking okay, because right now he can deal with the teacher, and then there's only 2 cards in hand, so he hopes there's no Gadgetzan with anything else.
He just needs like a feeler turn 7. To just breach himself with Tornado when he can just rag.
And now Tempo Gadgetzan is absolutely out of the question.
Yeah, I don't know.
You can get some backstab if you're really desperate.
The problem is like...
It's not that bad.
Yeah.
Wait, what about Leroy? Just Leroy.
Oh, yeah, Leroy
yeah,
might
yeah,
be,
it's interesting.
Leroy might be better than Gadgetzan backstab.
Tempo Leroy.
If you Leroy, you don't backstab. If you Leroy, you want the backstab for auctioneer to cycle the next turns.
Yeah.
So you either Leroy and no backstab, or you get some backstab and cycle.
Mm-hmm. I think I prefer Leroy right now.
It's a small chance of Gadget surviving when your opponent has Fiery War Axe. Like, he will probably kill it. And then you run. Then you have no more card draw. Okay.
Yeah, Leroy is much better there. Because of the weapon. And your opponent obviously had options. Like, I think Ikop gave a signal that he might have an execute because he was thinking so long about what to do with the Violet Teacher.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really like this line from Thais. Spot on as usual. Second Fiery War Axe. You might attack and equip it now. Just play Frothing, kill Leroy, equip Fiery War Axe, armor up. yeah, efficiently like, using 7
don't
mana.
Don't you want to have a 6/6 on board?
If you play your last dragon, then you can draw some cards like Corruptor.
Oh, right, your Corruptor doesn't work then.
I don't know, it may be the line, but I feel like it's never good to not have dragons in your hand.
Yeah, I agree. I was like, I actually didn't notice the fact that this is the last dragon, so I agree with keeping the Crusher. Like, if you have like another dragon, then obviously 6/6 would be better.
Maybe even armoring up is like essential in this thing.
Oh, I think you can play Tompkins here.
Yeah, you have to. You can upload Shinir.
Kill the 3/4.
Do you play backstab?
Or no. You face tank it.
Yeah. It's not that much damage.
You play backstab if you play Auctioneer. But I think Pillager attack is better. Mm-hmm. I don't know. They're both like pretty bad to Rag. Like Taish is now hoping that the coin that he's gonna get from Pillager next turn most likely. And the two draws. The one draw. And then the two draws from the spells are gonna like make
conceal or cheap spell.
He already played the conceal. So like he needs the second conceal.
Eviscerate is gonna be a good card anyway, I believe.
I don't like this play from Ekop that much. I mean it's fine, but
why not?
Isn't Rag better?
If Rag hits face, you have the weapon, you're at 16. If Rag hits face, you are at
you 11. Saw Leroy already, right?
You've seen Leroy, yeah. So it's like unlikely your opponent has 10 damage, I think. You've seen Coldblood as well in the very beginning.
I think Dyke's like the line of not playing Gachetan early got punished because now it's just too late. But I'm not sure.
Well, he would just lose it if he would play it earlier.
Yeah, I don't think he got.
Yeah, but
he would have lost either way, I think.
I don't know, but at least Ekop had to remove and.
Oh, prep into concede.
I mean, it's not good to be like results oriented. I think he went for the play with the highest percentage, even though the play with like lower percentage could like end up being good for him. It doesn't mean that he's the correct play.
Yeah, that's true. But I was thinking about playing Gachetan as a tempo. But I agree. You draw Tom Pillager on time, so yeah, it's fine.
I think Gromash is better against Sab than Rag is, so maybe it doesn't keep play from Ekop. Yeah, I guess both were all good.
They're really similar plays.
Yeah.
And now what? Ragnaros, right?
With Ragnaros, you have a chance to kill Gadgetzan. If you hit face, you will have lethal with Grom next turn.
Yeah, now you shoot Rag, I think.
Yeah, because Gadgetzan can still be dangerous.
Can you die? I think you can die. There are ways to die.
There's one more Coldbloods and double Eviscerate?
Yeah, no,
one
Eviscerate.
One Eviscerate.
So it's 8 damage, 12 damage.
Oh, one Eviscerate.
Yeah, only one Eviscerate.
Yeah. Well.
So it's basically 12 damage from those cards, and you need to have...
another Deadly Poison.
How many cards does Tice have?
Actually, a Psy. Like, Coldblood into... I will check it in just give a second. Tice is 12.
12 cards. Okay, he's doable. He needs like a channeling spell that can start the cycle. He used both preps, he used backstab. What else he has?
Well, if he gets Talnos on board, then plays Coldblood, Eviscerate, it's 3/5, and then SI7, it's enough with the weapon attack, right?
If Rag is also near, there's nothing, so he only has a chance if Rag.
Yeah, obviously, if Rag hits face.
Yeah.
I like the Rag here from Ekop.
Boom. Okay, there is a chance.
Sap, okay.
Sap doesn't help.
It's okay, you can just channel.
It's just a spell.
You need mana for like Coldblood, Eviscerate, and SA7.
Oops.
Talnos backstab.
Like, here.
The thing is that Thais knows that Ekop has Gromash in his hand because he sapped it. So like, he knows he needs to win this game.
This turn.
I think now he doesn't have mana to win this game. Nah. Yeah, we found out nice.
Yeah, no more preps either.
Yeah, but with Eviscerate, Coldblood, SI, he would need 6 mana and he had only 5 after this.
Maybe Farseer was okay.
Yeah, Farseer will save him from Gromash charge.
Nah, that's GG already.
Yep.
Was it even correct to play the Fan of Knives if you know you have no outs?
Just to see what you have?
What? What do you mean?
I mean, you're showing 2 more cards off your deck.
Okay.
Well, not to Ekop.
To the stream.
To the stream.
Yeah, I guess.
Not sure if it matters that much, just like... That's like the only thing that you can consider a slight misplay from Thais.
Just showing too many cards.
Both players played really, really well this game. Like, super high level.
Yeah, I liked it. And Ekop is taking game number 1 with that Dragon Warrior that was, I believe, slightly favored versus Rogue.
Yeah.
If I have to find a mistake or on Nikop, it was like playing too fast the Gromash.
He could have considered like how powerful and impactful his rug in both situations, because there's not that much to use the time on anyways.
Just to find a small, not mistake. Not
yeah.
This matchup is interesting, by the way. Some people say that the Dragon Warrior players say that it's like super favored for Dragon Warrior, and the Druid players say that they are favored.
Yeah, it's like it's really close to 50-50, I think, because it really depends what Druid does. Like Dragon Warrior is going to do what Dragon Warrior does, just try to play on curve and smash face when possible. But Druid can do some crazy things with innervates. I think I would prefer to be Druid in this matchup, actually. I played both like a lot of times.
Yeah, really? you like to be in rough spots with the Druids and then you win. I know that, but I prefer like to be Warrior because it's just too easy to go face sometimes, and the Druid has to... Oh, look at this, Onyxia plus... Soul of the Forest.
Yeah, Onyxia is a nice addition, and Soul of the Forest actually rotated out from this list. Like it was super, it was playable and with the Wisp of the Old God that Jackie Chan was playing before, mm-hmm. and an addition to the deck right now. It's interesting. Ardy, can you tell us more about this, or is it a secret?
I mean, it's just anti-control deck. Osaka had it too.
Oh really? Okay.
Yeah. It's pretty common.
I think it's great when there's like a ghoul or like brawl or whatever, and you just get the board back.
In some of the matchups, it's just like insta win. If you already have some minions on the board, you just like secure it. That Wild Growth was pretty spot on. Like it was really needed in this situation.
Because his hand is not that good.
But do you think the deck has to improve against control? It's not good enough.
I mean,
I prefer to have a better card against aggro.
Like what?
I don't know, maybe...
Voodoo Doctor?
Just to heal yourself a bit more.
And no, I don't know.
Pressure from 2-1. Well, there are different strategies. Like, versus aggro, I'd say we play double Ancient of War, for example.
Or another Druid of the Claw.
Yeah. It's double Druid. Like, do you play one Mire Keeper? Do you play two Mire Keepers? Do you play Onyxia and Scenarios? Or do you play something even... different. So there is a couple of flexible cards in this matchup that they can actually switch.
I think you're up for one, just like cycle. You really want something.
You want a 5-drop for sure, like a 4-drop that you can play on next turn.
Yeah.
We haven't talked much. So like Tyson's hand is not good. That's a nice 4-drop. But what about Ekop's hand? He is Dragons. He is able to coin out Twilight Guardian next turn.
Yeah, so standard.
Yeah.
Standard hand.
Does he want to do that though?
You want to pressure.
I think Fairy is better.
Oh,
I
with Corruptor, you definitely keep the coin.
Even without Corruptor, I think the coin is like so valuable when you have like Draconid and Ragnaros in your hand. You can just like pretty much curve out. The coin is like more impactful later on. Like if you coin the 4-drop, how do you follow up with the 4-drop? To the 4-drop? Fairy Dragon Pass?
Armor up.
I mean,
you're floating one mana.
I mean, it's a bad follow-up. Like, you should use the coin to get more value.
You can also have, like, Execute for the next turn, because you have a 3-6 on board. If they play, like, a 4-drop, like a 3-5, you can attack Execute without losing a minion.
Another thing is that you expect the Druid player to, like, play a 5-drop and not Hero Power on turn 5. So, like, Fairy Dragon gets a bit more value. I think it was good how Echo played it.
What do you think about playing Azur Drake instead of Mirror Keeper into Ancient of War?
You float one mana again, Mario Keeper dies to the 3-2, and there can be an Execute that deals with Ancient War.
Yeah, I don't think you're in any rush. I think it's fine.
So it seems like your next turn you're going to play Mario Keeper,
Power of the Wild.
Plus Power of the Wild?
You don't need to play the 2-2. It depends. Maybe.
Just because of the curve.
I think also this is quite nice because on 4 you expect Corruptor to be happening with the coin. So then like Ekop will have to deal 6 damage to the Drake to kill it.
Yeah.
And you can't let Drake on board.
Mm-hmm. It's like not that great against Ravaging Ghoul, but again, if your opponent plays Ravaging Ghoul on turn 4. Other than 3, he's like pretty much good.
Yeah, you're still happy about that. Well, for Ekop here, so like...
He has a hard turn as Dragon Warrior.
Corruptor like, is still an option here.
Pretty impressive. You try like Guardian and probably...
Trade the 1-1?
That's about to swipe.
It's about to swipe anyway,
never mind.
I like Corruptor. Just to be able to clear most of the board and have a 5-4.
I'm not sure. Maybe trading the 1-1 was better and playing the Twilight Guardian. You waste damage playing Corruptor, and you'll not be able to make use of Execute either.
Yeah, but the thing is, like, Corruptor is more of a powerful play, more of a power play as well, so that you can actually start doing some damage. With the 3-6, that's a really defensive play, I think.
Yeah, but like the defensive play now sets up for a more impactful play later.
So what would you do next turn? Just Corruptor to finish something off and then go for Crusher? Because right now your turn five will be awkward. You only have Twilight Guardian and Execute. They will not have any targets.
You could also Violet Teacher, Pearl of the Wild here is just the play you have to do.
Violet
is efficient on mana. You have already 1-1 on board. Next turn you're gonna play Unseen of War.
I mean, you have no other option, right?
I'm solo. The forest will get value.
Will it?
Eventually.
It will get value if you expect your minions to not die, which is unlikely.
Oh, fireworks. Nice.
Yeah, you can use it to like proc the execute.
And kill the 4-6, kill the 2-2 with the trade.
And then you just play Fairy Dragon, right? Because like you give him two good targets and then you still end up having one of the good targets surviving. And you still have dragons in your hand. Maybe. Which is interesting. Like, so many times you just, like, run out of dragons. That's one of the issues with this deck.
I think, like, people started cutting fairy dragons. That's why the issue appears. Do you still, like, play fairy dragons in your list?
Yeah, I play.
Okay.
Some people cut one fairy for the Deathwing.
They're, like, Deathwing or Onyx, yeah.
Malkorok for Deathwing.
Yeah, they cut Malkorok or they cut... it really depends. Like, I've seen versions without fairy dragons, without Malkorok. With Deathwing, with Onyxia, some people play Inner Rage as well to have a more of an aggressive approach. I played like version with Acolytes of Pain, for example, without Fairy Dragons, which is
without Whirlwinds.
Without Whirlwinds, yeah. It was like awkward because Acolyte of Pain is not a tempo card, but still like provided you like end game solutions.
So now Unseen of War, and then next turn, Mire Keeper plus Soul of the Forest.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
So that means you are going to trade the 3-2 instead of the 5-4?
You trade the 5-4, right?
You kill the 5-4.
Okay.
But actually, yeah, it was better for Ekop to go face with the 5-4 last turn because he had the extra incentive for the Draconid Crusher. Mm-hmm. But I don't think trading was that bad either. It wasn't that great.
Tice decided not to kill the 5-4.
Yeah, because he's thinking of getting value of the Soul of the Forest, more value.
Yeah, but then like...
On the other hand, you get more wrecked by Execute. It's only the better play if you make the read that he doesn't have Execute in his hand.
Which he already played one, so it's not that likely.
So
but yeah, he can have a Slam.
Slam, so. I was thinking about Slam specifically because Slam really deals with the 5-10. Well, it's not pretty because Ekop then has to also like face tank the 5-10 and lose the 5-4.
Also, you could make the read that he doesn't have Slam because if he had Slam, he would have used it on his Drake. Maybe that's how Thais thought of this turn.
I think actually even if he has Slam, you're still happy about it because he will only have 4 mana left. And then...
Yeah, and again, he doesn't have like... Actually, he might have a 4 drop in his hand.
Yeah, but still, like, he used the weapon, he's losing the 5-4 and you still end up with the 2-2 on your board.
No, but in a situation where you can read that he doesn't have Slam and Execute, which Thais probably did, this is like by far the best play.
True.
It sets up you perfectly on board and it punishes your opponent massively. And look at your turns, you have Mire Keeper, Soul of the Forest into Onyxia.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Into
Tenarius even. Better than Onyxia.
That's really good because Soul of the Forest will guarantee that something sticks. And then Down guarantees that Soul of the Forest procs.
And Ekop is at 18 already. It is really dangerous for him. I think this is basically game.
I think you can go face now.
Yeah,
like
Thais is going to show him who's the face deck.
Yeah.
That's why I prefer to be the Druid in this matchup.
And it's going to be lethal no matter what with Tenarius, right? If you go face, I mean.
Yeah, because he has to kill the Taunt. If he kills the Taunt, you get a Soul of the Forest guy.
So I'm like surprised on how Thais managed the mana curve. It was always like perfect every turn. We were discussing when he played Mire Keeper or Azure Drake on turn 5, but it seems like he had everything under control. And now his scenario is lethal.
Yeah, he played it really well.
I don't know if it's lethal actually. Because there's a bad trade on board, so yeah, it's not lethal. Oh, wait.
No, you can't play it, but... Reynard actually just lost 3-1 to Terence, so Reynard is eliminated from the tournament, unfortunately. But a lot of Temple Storm players still survive in that. We are going definitely to have Reynard around at casting and playing some fun games and fighting for Team Horus. But Terence is the guy who's going to play versus the loser of this match.
Team Horus is like the Horde, and Team Anubis is like the Alliance, right?
Wait, that's flipped. I mean, I would agree with that because I'm Horde, but you actually have like red badges.
Oh, okay.
No, let me tell you how it is. Team Anubis is the good team. Team Horus is the bad team.
Oh shit.
Wait, no, the evil team, and you're like the Paladin guys.
It's Euro better than NA all the time.
It's hard to disagree.
when we are all from EU.
Yeah, why are you in Team Horus? Are you like, did they go like not good enough for Team EU? So you go to NA Nimsh?
I don't know, man.
No, Nimsh is just now top 50 on ladder, so he should be on Team Anubis.
Wow. Top 50 is like insane.
Yeah.
Can I get an autograph, please?
Come on, please. What rank are you, or do you?
I'm like 100, but I had to prepare for history. No, I'm just joking. Like top 50 is definitely good. If you manage to hold top 50, that's actually insane. But top 50 now doesn't mean that much. Like you can be like top 10 in the last day and still drop out of top 100.
Yes, that's why you should try for top 5, top 3.
Yeah, yeah. You have to like go really.
If you want to avoid the DK at least.
Yeah, yeah. The DK is massive on Europe. A lot of people play on Europe.
So we have 1-1 at the moment.
Yeah.
Yes, we had that Druid win, and Tyce is going to stay with his Druid deck because this is last hero standing, best of 5. You just keep the deck that you're winning with. You're not punished by the fact that you're winning. You can play with a cool deck that's carrying you.
Okay, time for Zoo. So now we can analyze more in depth the matchups.
Oh, really? So like,
it's easier to misplay with Zoo than with other decks.
It is, but then this matchup again, what do you think the percentage is? Like,
I think Zoo is favored.
Yeah.
How much?
Less than 58, I would say. Like
less
between 55 and 58.
I have days when I think it's 55 for Zoo, and I have days when I think it's 60% for Zoo. Like some games are so one-sided from Zoo's perspective.
Yeah, like whenever I play Zoo against Druid, if they beat me, I feel like a lot of things had to go their way.
Yeah.
Like way too many things had
exactly,
to go their way.
Exactly, exactly. All right, so we are in agreement. This is a really good matchup for Ekop and Hearthstone Terms, at least.
His hand is also really good, but I don't like the Soulfire in his hand. Like, there's like hype recently about Soulfire, but I don't think he's like the best card to play in Zoo. I think just people trying to be too fancy is what happens right now. It's like, oh, Forbidden Ritual, let's cut it. Let's play Soulfire because 6-1 a tournament with people bringing bad decks.
Well, I'm not playing Soulfire in my list, but this is extra reach they were getting. If you play Soulfire, do you play Doomguards as well, or do you play Leroy list?
I have no idea. I just don't play Soulfire.
I played double Doomguard, one Sea Giant, no Soulfire.
I think that's also wrong. I don't think you should play Sea Giant if you have Doomguards. Usually, they don't really work well together. To maximize the value, you should just ban Zoo, which is like the matchup where you want Sea Giant the most, and then you can afford not playing Sea Giant and maximize the efficiency of Zoo.
I'm talking a ladder, actually. But for the tournament, I agree you should play like double Doomguard, no Sea Giant, or just double Sea Giant.
Yeah, yeah. I like the way both played it until now. You don't want to play Juggler first, and you don't want to like keep anything for the Juggler. I think just dropping both one-drops was correct.
Yeah, but this shows the problem that Druid has no turn 3. Only the hero power.
Yeah, but look at the Zoo hand. It's garbage. You probably have to tap here. Yeah, you'll probably have to tap.
You
tap.
Can you play... No, you don't. You probably tap, you're right. Oh my god.
Tap, go face.
Yeah, that's the only play. Like, there's nothing else. Because like, if you play Juggler, you just throw Juggler away. That doesn't make sense. And it's better to play Juggler with Abusive next turn if you really want to. But Gambles obviously is the play next turn. Soulfire doesn't do anything. So if you play an Abusive and a Soulfire, one of the minions go face, like you lose the whole board anyway, and you just give the hero power to your opponent next turn. So
you will have only one card left, which is Curry.
Yeah. So life tap it is.
But maybe I think Knife Juggler is not that bad here.
It is very bad.
You won Knife
Jagger. Literally trades a 2-1 into it.
You won Knife Juggler on 4. You won Knife Juggler after Imp Gang Boss, so that you get the Imps and Juggles flying.
Okay. Yeah. Echo opted for the right play. And Dice is not in the best situation ever. He has a weird curve.
No free drop. Well, no play on
no
free.
Innervate.
No
That's
innervate,
usually what
sure.
Druid does on free, the innervate.
Yeah. Yeah.
He tries to, like, trick Echo into thinking that he has something in the hand. I mean, you have to be pretty dumb to, like, think that the Druid has something in the hand and he doesn't play it. Like, if they had something, they would play. There's no card that the Druid could have and they would be able to play and not play.
Yeah, I'm thinking...
Maybe Mulch.
Yeah, Mulch. Would you, you Feral Rage? Like, if you have Feral Rage, you Feral Rage.
Yeah, you Feral Rage. And if he had Mulch, he wouldn't even consider it. Thais, like... We're talking about Thais here.
He's yeah.
You wouldn't even consider playing Mulch.
Mulch is probably the only card you will not play here, even if you have it. Because Imp Gang Boss is a much better target for Mulch.
Yeah. So now Mire Keeper hits. Ooh, Wildgrowth too late. Now Wildgrowth already becomes worse than Mire Keeper. It's like,
yeah.
Strictly better to play Mire Keeper.
Definitely. Just get a free Mana Crystal, go face for two.
And now we can see that the Juggler in Echo of Sand is going to be way better.
Yeah, of course.
Imagine if you would have played it on turn two.
Yeah, it was a disaster, right?
Yeah.
All right, so back to E-Cup with Juggler. And you can easily, like, abusive attack. Do you try to play around Swipe in a way? Maybe you saw Fire?
I don't know.
And you before he actually misses the 2-1.
Yeah, it's 75% to hit it.
Okay.
So
at least he's not going to lose the Juggler.
Yeah.
Every time like this happens, I'm like, oh, Knife Juggler, you killed yourself. Why did you do it? You just really wanted to die, I guess.
And now maybe Fandral Wrath, because Knife Juggler is just too annoying.
Yeah, Thais wanted to Swipe here. Swipe would have been like great. Especially since Echo plays Sea Giant and he wouldn't be able to like play it, and then so far he's also not playable.
Swipe would actually give Thais a really good chance to win this game.
Yeah, actually.
Yeah, because then he has the follow-up with Water.
It also blocks the Sea Giant in a way. And now E-Cup can play Sea Giant and trade his stuff into Fandral and then go face with the rest. And this is also like a question for Mulch. So like you play Sea Giant and you ask Thais, do you have Mulch? Sylvanas is a card, but might be too slow, so Ancient of War. Like, yeah, we'll see what Thais will do, but I think Sea Giant's play here.
Yeah, Sea Giant double trade.
Sylvanas is an interesting choice for the Druid. I don't play Sylvanas, but I think it's really interesting. It's slow.
It's anti-control, right?
Yeah, it is.
So
yeah.
Again, like just the Druid wanting to beat control decks. You trade the Imgang boss here because you know he doesn't have Swipe. If he had Swipe, he would have played it last turn.
Yeah.
Maximizing the value.
But that's actually a good point. Like, Sylvanas is definitely not popular in the Oxarn Druid decks.
I like this trade too, by the way. It's only better to keep more minions if you want to like either play into your second Sea Giant or play into Direwolf Alpha. Otherwise, this is more resilient to have the Flame Imp.
So now from Thais's perspective, if you play Ancient of War...
It feels so bad, but he's thinking about having any removal.
He's thinking about Sylvanas here. He wants a Sylvanas and then like magically steal the 8-8 and then play a war afterwards.
This makes sense in a way because there's 12 damage, so Zul should not kill you next turn.
But also if you play Sylvanas and you don't steal anything good, like you are gonna die in 2 turns.
Yeah, Echo can put Thais in a situation where he doesn't draw anything good.
Yeah, maybe you can go Ancient of War and then pray for a removal for the 8-8.
I think at this spot, like, you kind of try to play till Yogg-Saron and then hope Yogg-Saron actually carries you. But he didn't even play that many spells.
Can he even survive?
Until he might not survive. That's the main problem as well. And that when you try to rely on Yogg-Saron as your winning strategy, it means you're losing the game.
Yeah, great card.
I think Ancient of War and you pray for Wrath or Swipe here.
Yeah, because with Sylvanas, like, if you play Ancient of War next turn, you'll be able to play something else with Sylvanas, possibly. And, like, if you just play Sylvanas here, Ancient of War, you maybe will have one mana for Living Roots. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
Actually, like, if you get a Living Roots, it might not be that bad, because then you, like, kill Flame Imp and you Living Roots Sylvanas, try to steal an 8-8 and have your 5-10. So, like, it's a possible scenario that can maybe happen.
The problem with Sui is, like, he's always going to play a lot of minions every turn, so Sylvanas is just not that likely to have a good... to get good value.
Yeah.
But I don't know. It feels bad to play Ancient of War when there is a 8-8 on board. Yeah, that's the problem right now. Like, what do you do? Innervate Yogg, but you don't have Yogg.
Yeah, that's the problem.
So Azur Drake and pray for Swipe.
Yeah.
If you get Swipe,
oh, no, you need more mana.
Good is it?
No, I have enough with Innervate.
Okay, you can Swipe the 1/3.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fine.
Swipe the 1/3.
Pray.
Train to the Sea Giant and then steal the 8/1 Sea Giant is still super bad.
Well, you can steal the 2/1 charge and then charge it into the...
Oh, yeah.
That's better.
That's insane. How many cards, Nimsh?
Cards left for Thais. 19.
So, 2 out of 19 is not that much. It's roughly 10%.
So, this should be lethal. This is 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 damage. Yep. Yeah, this is lethal.
What? All right,
so Ekop is just counting the cards, so counting the damage, see what's going to happen. But it means like Ekop is getting a lead 2-1 versus Thais, and Thais's last deck will be Shaman. And I've heard Shaman is not that good versus Zoo. Unless it's a Conceit Shaman. That is awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. But as we say, like, Ekop is playing like perfectly. RDU, which is like one of the best Zoo players, is like agreeing with all the plays that Ekop is doing. So yeah, I'm impressed.
I don't think we can trust RDU on the Zoo plays at the moment, because he is Team Anubis and Ekop is Team Anubis. So obviously he's going to like look at the plays and be like, yeah, Team Anubis, go!
Yeah,
Anubis,
but Thais is Team Anubis and Thais is also Team G2.
True, exactly. What are you doing at this couch at the moment, RDU?
I know.
Or did you just agreeing with Zeus?
Yeah,
he doesn't care about the tides anymore. It's just the Zeus.
Yeah, it's just like maybe surprising that both players are actually playing good.
Why is it surprising? Dude, it should happen. It's a high-level tournament.
I'm just joking. No, but the way you put it, like the way you say it, is like, oh, you're agreeing too much with them. Like, I'm usually the guy that doesn't agree, but both players are just playing really...
Find something. Punish them, or you just...
There's nothing to find. They just play way too good.
Look at their hairstyles. I don't know, like, take it third away. You have to take it beyond. You have to embrace your hate.
No, they're both playing top tier Hearthstone right now.
And that's awesome to watch. Yeah. Since 3-5.
It's a delight to finally watch some good Hearthstone after having to cast some subpar Hearthstone in some other tournaments.
Shots fired again.
He always find a way like to blame.
Yeah, he can't fire the shots at the players right now, so he's firing shots at everybody else.
Of course.
Yeah. And before I'll get like a lot of haters, it's like, oh, this RDU guy tries to sound like a smart ass. I'm just trolling mostly.
Alright, so Zoo versus Shaman, this is not a Conceit Shaman. It seems like an aggro version. We've seen Lava Burst in the Mulligan as well.
This matchup is pretty close. Right?
I would play Zoo all of the time, I think. I think this is actually favoring Zoo.
Yeah, it's favoring Zoo, but if the Shaman runs Lightning Storm, then the Shaman also has like some edges.
It's close if there is Lightning Storm, yes. If there's no Lightning Storms, this is heavily Zoo favored, I think.
I also noticed one thing by playing a lot of Zoo, is like if the Shaman has Trog, and the way to protect the Trog, and the way to buff Trog, then they have like serious chances, because you don't have a way to deal with the 1/3 with Zoo that efficiently.
Yeah,
if also, they just like keep trading you.
Also, what I really like when I'm playing Shaman versus Zoo is getting Finley and trying to change my hero power as soon as possible to Fire Blast or Life Tap, to be able to just either like, or like even Shapeshift, to be able to just continue trading and
efficiently.
Yeah, efficiently, and then get just cards to be able to go 1-1 versus Zoo. Because what normally happens is like Zoo wins the early game, and then you just play catch up as Shaman, and they stay at like 20, health. So you can't really kill them, and you still need to like use your spells to fight for board. And they're like, yeah, sure, I can fight for board all day with all
you the have to health. Choose, like, in some point, you have to choose in, like, remove everything and die slowly, or just go face and pray for the top deck.
Yeah.
It's usually the way to go sometimes, like, against Zoo.
Early game is super important, and right now, Tice, even though he got double Trog, he can't really kill this 2-2, which means that one of the minions that he plays is going... Well, actually, it's going to die, because Imgangbos is the play next turn.
You probably have to play both Wandros and just hope you draw Lava Burst or Feral Spirit and go for face with your Trog. Play the square on one of the sides because you want to maximize Flame Tongue efficiency.
Yeah, yeah. So like on the left is probably the best.
Yeah, yeah. Because if you play it on the right, it can interact with the totems. So perfect placement.
He's gonna play...
What did he draw into? What is the card he's holding?
Knife Juggler.
Knife Juggler, okay. Yeah, so Knife Juggler is okay. Because as you mentioned, like you do kind of expect Feral Spirit next turn, and if Feral Spirit is being played, it's so hard to recover from there. And that Knife Juggler was okay as well, just getting rid of the shield.
You're still Tusker here, right?
I'm not sure.
Okay, if you play the Tengolem, you can Tusker next turn actually, and you trade the 1-1 into the 2-1 and trade the 2-3 into the Knife Juggler.
Yeah, that's much better, I think.
Yeah, that's actually
I'm not
much
sure.
Better.
I'm not sure. I have my doubts here.
Yeah, the Tengolem is better actually, right?
Yeah, I think Totem Golem is better. Just kill the wolf, kill the juggler, and you have a 3-4 and a 1 and a 2-1 on board after that.
The juggler is not the problem here. Like, you had
the juggler can be the problem.
A totem and a 1-1, so it's only 33% of win rate to hit the 1-1 because you were going to trade first the totem. So it wasn't that bad. But yeah, I don't know. I don't know. It was interesting at least.
Yeah, I think that it is actually close.
Yeah, like...
You trade first, I guess. You trade first here, and then you play Imgangbos.
This way you don't float any mana, but you can get wrecked by the juggler. But if you try to like play perfectly efficiently, you have to go like this, but I don't know.
I'm not sure.
I would be afraid to do this play, because if there is a ritual, you might end up in a really bad spot, right? After ritual.
Yeah, I think Golem was better for Tyze.
Yeah.
Playing Golem there was better. He would have Tusker now, he'd have a better trades.
Exactly. Alright, he decided for Tusker though, and...
Now I think you have to play Lightning Bolt in the Knife Juggler. I mean, for the same reason at the turn before.
Yeah.
And... if you play like Totem Golem and Hero Power, you have to trade. No, I don't like it. I think I could play here Lightning Bolt, Totem Golem, go face. And you are not on a good spot, of course. You're going to play next turn Thing from Below for 4 mana and pray for Doomhammer soon. I don't know.
Will you, though? Because if you play Totem Golem and Bolt, you will have Overload for 2.
So you
can't play Thing from Below.
So it's even
the worst situation.
Yeah, so Hero Power. Oh,
well, you still might go for it, but you don't have the play, really.
Yeah. I don't know. Then, if you like play things, I think I don't play Lightning Bolt there.
I like Hero Power a bit more.
That's so bad. The second power overwhelming.
If you'd have played Hero Power and would have gotten Spell Power and the Lucky Juggler, then he could like trade the Imgangbos efficiently, and then leave the Juggler for one more turn, but the Healing Totem might take it out of reach. Maybe it was better for Tyze. Maybe it was like a Hail Mary play just to go for the spell power. 33%. Click the in-gang boss. Now he gets kind of farmed.
Taunt was good as well.
Taunt was okay, yeah.
Because you play Totem Golem.
Yeah, and then you can still have access to the Thing from Below.
Mm-hmm. And Lava Burst.
That's a bit late right now.
Yeah.
Well, it's still something that he can play at least. And that he will still be able to play the Thing from Below next turn after this.
If you Lava Burst, you have to Lava Burst Direwolf, so you do it first.
Yeah, Direwolf and then kill the 1-3 with the 3-4.
Is it even good enough? I think straight up Toteming might be better.
But you have to play it, like, you can't pass the turn without playing anything.
Yeah, I guess, okay, this is better, but it's not something that you like to do.
No, of course, but the turn before was pretty much the same.
And Ikop finally will be able to use the first PO at least to deal with the Totem Golem and then kill the Totem normally as well. Can he...
Just PO the 1-1, trade into the 3-4. 2-1 into 0-2.
Yeah, you're in a good spot, and then he has second PO for a possible 5-5 next turn. He doesn't have a small minion to PO. Oh man, second Lava Burst.
You might just like play Thing from Below here, to be honest.
Yeah, you have to.
Yeah. And just hope he doesn't have the means to buff it.
Ritual.
Yeah, PO is even worse than Ritual because he can like PO the Im Yang boss and like...
Oh man, he can get the Storm Task Boar. That would be so good.
But then Thais can like Lava Burst next turn, so it's still like a good play from Thais. What Thais needs is like Doomhammer. If he gets Doomhammer, he can like put a 1 o'clock. He's like, hey, you don't draw two per turn.
Doomhammer from Thais and then no Defender of Argus from Ikop.
Yeah, yeah.
Because Defender of Argus can just seal this game.
Yeah, definitely.
So we go for Stone Task Boar. I wonder if he's going
to... He has like Flaming Voidwalker, Angry Chicken as his options. Instantly picks the Voidwalker, which is like one of the greatest cards against Shaman.
Yeah, especially versus Doomhammer that we mentioned.
But this is pretty much like Argus because you have two Voidwalkers. So even if you draw, if Thais draw Doomhammer here, it's not going to be in a good spot.
Yeah, Doomhammer is terrible here.
I think I'll just play only one Voidwalker, by the way, to play around the Lightning Storm. Or do you guys like to?
I don't know. One damage is not that much. You can save one Voidwalker.
Well, I'm not sure if Thais is playing Lightning Storm at
all. Yeah, but Ikop doesn't know
the
deck list.
I think it's a close. Like, Voidwalker may even survive the storm, but I think I'd like to have this extra turn in hand.
Thais didn't have like the good draw. The draw that was like good enough to like win him this matchup.
Yeah, you really have to have really good draw to win as a Shaman. If he has just normal cards, because if he played versus other decks, he might have won with that draw. But versus Zul, like you have to have.
You can see the difference between the card draw.
Yeah, four cards up.
Four more cards. It's just too much, right?
Also, his turn four was not a 7-7.
Yeah. Well, there was double PO, so 7-7 was actually manageable. So Taskar's timing has to summon...
Has to summon Elemental Destruction.
Yes! Yeah, now Zul is just going to continue maintaining the...
Oh, that's a Sea Giant.
Oh, Sea Giant?
Yes, I think so. It was 8-8.
Sea Giant, that's Sea Giant. Sea Giant is awesome because this board was still a bit vulnerable to a Lightning Storm if it is in Thais' deck, but Sea Giant is unanswerable. Like, you can't do much as a Nagra Shaman. As a Nagra Shaman, you have to ignore it or just kill it with Lava Burst. We've seen double Lava Burst already. So, Lava Burst is something, obviously.
Nah, that's... The game is... like in favor for Ikop. He's gonna take the series against Tides.
Yeah, so Ikop, it seems he's going to advance from his group.
6-0 with Zul.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Wait, with this Zul, I think this is the second win.
He reverse sweep.
He won. No, he won with. Yeah, but like with this matchup, he won with Warrior.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so it's 5-0.
It's 5-0 with Zul. So yeah, a lot of people said like, do you ban Warrior, do you ban Warlock? Thais banned Shaman, and he's losing this one. He won versus Terrence. He's going to play versus Terrence again, which means that Terrence will have a chance to for a matchup. But Ikop is the winner. Ikop is going through to day 3 of Seed Story Cup 5, and he's definitely happy. Winning versus Thais, double European champion, is a great achievement. So Cloud9 getting this one for sure.
Good job, Ikop.
So are you? Who do you hate right now?
What do you mean?
Do you have like? Do you hate any plays? Do you hate any players? All good.
Come on, Nimsh.
All right. Okay, so Ikop is coming here. I'm not sure if we have the mic for Ikop. There should be one on the table. Oh, you got a headset? Yeah, headset is cool. So Ikop, really? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All good. Okay. So unfortunately, you get points. Oh, you don't get points for Team Anubis, so it's fine then. So congratulations, you advanced to day 3, and Team Anubis is definitely happy that one of the Team Anubis won.
Dude, Team Anubis for life, woof woof!
All right, I wonder if the Team Anubis will actually transition and transcend this Historic Cup 5. You know, people just bringing those badges to like...
But you know, Thais was also Anubis, so...
Yeah, I know. So Team Anubis won and lost at the same time. at the same time, actually, Terrence was able to win versus Reynard. So Reynard is eliminated from the tournament.
Oh, I see. Wait, did he play at the same time?
Yeah, they played at the same time.
Okay.
But overall, Zoo, like 5-0 with Zoo. So you expected Thijs to ban your Shaman. How did you?
Yeah, I mean, because he plays the same class as Reynard, so I assumed he would ban Shaman. But I mean, why would you change a winning strategy? Just ban Warrior again, and yeah.
So coming into that matchup, did you think you're favored matchup-wise, or did you think like Thijs is favored?
No, I think it was pretty much the same thing as versus Reynard. I mean, it can go either way, but yeah, Zoo seems to be strong, and shame on them for not bringing it.
Well, yeah, Zoo is really good, and I feel like you had a good matchup versus that York Druid and a good matchup versus Shaman, so the fact that Zoo actually stayed alive was really good for you. And RDU was watching the game, and he was liking your play so much that he started hating on some other people outside.
Yeah, I was saying, like, the plays that you and Thijs made were, like, so good that, like, it was insane. Like, I never watched this good quality Hearthstone for a long time.
Oh, thank you. That means so much from you.
Yeah, you both played really well. It was like just a back and forth of really well-played games.
Thank you.
And AK Wonder, do you have any questions for Ika?
No, I was just surprised watching RDU not blaming the players. and yeah, I want to congratulate you both because we saw like high plays and everything. I think I could make some mistakes if I could beat you in the Zoo versus Druid matchup. So yeah, congratulations, and it's amazing you're on the next day, man.
Yeah, I'm really happy about it, and Team I'm looking forward to it. And I'm gonna get drunk now.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, because like tomorrow you don't have to play, you can just chill and enjoy the tournament. And obviously for you guys, if you want to support Team Anubis here on the couch, tweet it, hashtag Team Anubis, and also Team Horus represents. Hashtag Team Horus.
Now screw also those guys. Just Team Anubis. That should be good.
No, Horus is good. Horus,
like, Nimsh is a traitor. He's from Europe and he's an NA team. Yeah. Not good enough to be European.
I didn't choose. It was the hat.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So the hat is a traitor, I guess.
Yeah.
I am secretly supporting Team Anubis as well. But don't tell anybody.
Okay.
Okay, guys. So that's this match. I believe we have one more for you at least. We have Thijs versus Terence M. We'll give some time for Thijs to recoup and gather his powers. And then we'll be back with more Hearthstone. Stay tuned.